today we are talking about green, integrated, or sustainable future. Can you share me what is the meaning of green integrated? What is the difference between green Tibet and greening Tibet? Okay.
Greening and green.
Yeah.
This is the two different terms and different technology. Technological, that is technological word.
Yeah.
Green means young. Young. Green means young. Very young.
No, no, not young.
Greening is to make young.
Okay.
Any other? This is the greening.
Okay, thank you very much. The green Tibet and greening Tibet, there are two different terms. The green Tibet means the Tibet program courses which is directly related with greening green technology, like alternative energy training, like solar PV technician, alternative energy programs, you know, directly related with green technology. Like if we introduce, the solar battery drive, motor driving system, that is green technology. The greening means in other occupations, if our approach, our process, our methodology, or whatever, you know, we teach, which contribute to make green, that is a kind of process, like greening Tibet is a process, okay? So, the present focus is greening Tibet, not only green Tibet. So every Tibet programs we have to contribute to make green.
Right.
Some will contribute, let's say, less than 1%. Some will contribute 5%. So greening Tibet for a sustainable future. This is one of the main agenda of the United Nations for our upcoming generations, global competitiveness. That's why today my presentation will cover introductions, what is greening Tibet, then education for sustainable development and Tibet, greening Tibet and green jobs, we'll discuss about that, and building an educational response that supports better planning for greening world. So we will discuss on this topic. Okay, the first, you know, the UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon, most of you know it, he mentioned that sustainable development is the pathway to the future we want for all. It offers a framework to generate economic growth, achieve social justice, exercise environmental stewardship and strengthen governance. So according to Ban Ki-moon, it means whatever Tibet program we develop or we implement in our member countries, that Tibet program should contribute for economic growth, generate economic growth means definitely through employment, that will do. Then achieve social justice. So we already discussed, like for global competitiveness, our graduates should be socially accepted, like social justice, how to behave in society, how to behave to the seniors, how to behave to the community, how to behave to employers, how to behave to, you know, co-workers. These are the social justice things we have to teach them. And exercise environmental stewardship, like Tibet graduates should work as a stewardship for environmental protection. So each and every courses which we deliver should contribute for the environmental protection. Our effort should contribute for the environmental, greening environment, and strengthen governance, definitely. So these are the basic elements of the sustainable development, that is according to Ban Ki-moon. Therefore, sustainable development is a development that meets the needs of the present, needs of the present. That meets needs of the present without compromising ability of the future generation to meet their own needs. That means if we do something, if we think about only our interest for 10 years, for 20 years, and if we destroy the environment, if we destroy the, you know, resources, our next generations will be suffer. That's why to give something, to hand over similar earth, similar environment, similar green jobs to the new generations, that is considered as sustainable development. That's why the TVET providers, we have to think for new generations. If we finish resources, gas or let's say petrol, within a 10 years, the new generation will suffer. So we have to teach technology to make sustainable development. So that is the key message of the sustainable development. Okay, if we see the sustainable development goals, because the after 2015, after completing Millennium Development Goal, MDGs, the United Nations has envisioned sustainable development goals with 17 different goals. Okay, all of we are aware about this. In this, like goal number 4, quality education, that is related with us. Similarly, number 13 is climate actions. These two are very much directly related with TVET, but other remaining goals are also indirectly related with TVET, like number 1, poverty, no poverty. If we provide very good, you know, quality, competitive competencies to the youth, they will get job and their earning will increase, their lifestyle will increase, they will contribute their earning to the health and education of the family, and good food, having a very nutritious food, they will be healthy and there will be no poverty. So TVET will contribute to that also. So these are the 17 goals of the SDGs. So our program should focus to achieve these goals. That is the another key interventions we have to initiate through the TVET. So regarding this, I will show you one video.
We can be, we must be, the first generation to end extreme poverty.
The generation
most determined
to fight injustice and inequalities.
The generation that saves the planet from climate change.
And this is how we will get done. The global goals.
A 15-year plan
for everyone, everywhere,
with no one left behind.
We live in a world where nobody,
anywhere, lives in extreme poverty. When no one
does celebrate,
when no one wakes in the morning,
us to eat them will be food tonight. We will live in a world where no child has died,
diseases we don't have insurance, and where proper health care
is a lifelong right for us all.
We will live in a world where everyone lives in school, and education gives us the knowledge
and skills
for a living life. We'll live in a world where all girls and all women have equal opportunities to thrive
and be powerful and safe.
We cannot succeed if we don't do that. We believe in a world where all people can get clean water,
have proper toilets,
and school as well.
We live in a world where there's sustainable energy for everyone.
Heat, light,
and power for the whole planet.
Without destroying the planet.
We live in a world where our economies prosper and new wealth.
Please.
Essentials for
everyone. And we live in a world
where architects,
our infrastructure, our
best innovations are not just in this domain, but they might make our lives better.
We live in a world
where prejudices and extremes of equality
are competing inside our countries and between different countries. Where people live in cities and communities
that are safe, progressive,
support every other most present.
Where we are safe.
Reality
for everyone, everywhere. These are the United Nations global
say to the government.
Let's make it work. Let's make it happen.
Okay. So these are the 17 sustainable development goals. Like one example, you know, if our Tibet graduates or let's say our Tibet systems, we will not think about sustainable development goals. Maybe one day, because of the one country's intervention, for example, if we destroy the environment in Nepal and India and Bhutan, because if we do not teach people how to protect the environment and how to, you know, like carbon-less earth, then the effect of that will come to Bangladesh. Because the landslides, all the soil erosions, then water will come to Bangladesh and the whole Bangladesh will be flooded.
Today's condition.
Yeah, today's like conditions is happening that. And another case, after 20 years, there will be no more island in Maldives and Philippines. You know, in Philippines, there are 7,000, 100, sometimes 644, and sometimes 600, sometimes 134. The island, the counting of island, every day there will be changed because of that climate. Sometimes they will shrink, sometimes they will evolve. So, because if we do not teach our youth for the sustainable development goals and proper technology, the whole environment will be destroyed, and one day there will be no more land in there. And all the land of the, you know, countries having oceans will be under the sea. So that will be the challenge for us. So we have to think about sustainable development goal, and every initiative what Tibet is taking, we have to think of that. That is the message. That's why Education for Sustainable Development and Tibet, it is called the ESD, Education for Sustainable Development. The ESD concept was coined by UNESCO as a way to integrate the pillars of education with the common practices in promoting sustainable development. That's why we call this ESD. And ESD promotes a sense of both local and global responsibility. So if we teach our students only about Bangladesh, or only about Sri Lanka, or only about India, and we will not fulfill our responsibility for the entire world, that might badly affect to other countries. So ESD means we have to promote, we have to develop our education system, Tibet systems, which can contribute for both local and global responsibility. So we have to think about other countries, not only our one. Like, you know, in village, most of the rural area, or let's say even city, if we throw our garbage from our house to road, we feel we are very happy, now clean. To send garbage from house to road means we are making, you know, dirty other to the other neighbors, to the country. So we have to think about the other neighbors, other road. So that is the part of things. So this ESD means, like, you know, sustainable development goals in our curriculum, we have to teach skills, how to, we'll discuss about how to, you know, utilize to make our environment better. Not only that, how to take responsibility. How to feel I am the responsible citizen of the society to make green environment. That is also one of the components we have to teach. Similarly, Tibet curricula towards the 6R. We have to apply in our curricula 6R principles. 6R means reuse. We have to teach our student how to apply reuse. The reuse means, for example, paper. The research, you know, we can use, normally we write in one side and we throw that. But on another side also we can use. That's simple example. Reuse, reduce. The resource we have to try to reduce. For example, sometimes we stay in a hotel, and most of the hotels these days you will find, you know, please try to reuse your towel and less water and drink things. But we feel, oh, we are in hotel, we are
even your food.
Yeah. We are paying and we throw a lot of water. And because of that, it will affect to ours. So reuse, reduce, renew. Then we have to try renewable energy. Renew, how to renew that? Then recycle, repair, and rethink. We have to start rethink also. If we think from our traditional way, we cannot contribute for sustainable development. So as a Tibet leader, or as a Tibet practitioner, we have to rethink on all remaining five R.
Six R.
So this is the six R principle. So in our Tibet programs, during curriculum development, during implementation of curriculum, in every, we have to think about 6R principle. Okay? So Tibet is heading towards sustainability. So how can we make Tibet towards sustainability? A change of the business as usual approach to sustainable development approach through the wise and practical usage of resources. So we have to use our resources practically. We should not make waste of resources. So in every course, every program, we have to teach our students. Like for example, if we are teaching, let's say, cooking training, hotel management, under hotel management, we are giving like, let's say, 6 months cooking training or chef training. And we think, oh, cooking training is not related with green technology. But during the cooking practice, if we use more gas, if we use more electricity, more waters, or more wastage of the food, means we are not contributing for sustainable development. That is a simple example. Similar to other electricity related training. So this type of things, we have to make a practical usage. And another is, economic sustainability, which requires a different and wider set of economically related knowledge, skills and attitude for production, management and consumption of goods and services. So during our training program, if we teach only hardcore technical skills, people will not think about the resources, about the uses, about the management, efficiency and effectiveness. So we have to inbuilt that component also, not only production. Use that according to 6R principles. So that is also very important. Similarly, social sustainability, which involves ensuring that the basic need of people, regardless of classification and state, satisfied. And always we have to, think about the basic needs of people. Like sometimes there is a one saying I want to share here. If you want to see the management of a person, how I am is a very good manager, or efficient manager, or resourceful manager, you have to check his either lunch or dinner plate. If the persons throw lot of waste, lot of food, cannot eat very properly, he is not good manager, or she is not good manager. You have to think before coming dinner plate, oh, how can I eat? How much volume I have to eat? You have to start your brainstorming. How much volume will be enough for me? Then start from little. We can add up, If we bring more and throw, that is not sustainable approach. That is not good management. That's why to evaluate good personality, or let's say good management, means check the dinner plate of the person. And if you want to check the how efficient is an organization, like this IDB. IDB, how IDB is very good organization. Just check the signboard of the organization. Or you have to check the under the table. If the under the table there are many dust and there is a like spider nets, means that organization is not good. If signboard is not properly maintained, so you cannot expect inside very good. So that is the organization. So to evaluate country, just see the traffic situation of the road. That is the simple indicator. So that is the one saying. It might not be true, but in most of the places, aspect, this is a, you know, reality also. That sometimes, you know, I realize when we visit China and other countries, there are a lot of population, but in China, they do not have much traffic jam. So,
it's okay.
We have to think about basic needs of the others and society. Then we can contribute. So, in Tibet for sustainability, we have to think about this. We have to change our mindset. We have to think about efficiency. Therefore, the another aspect, so still we are in introduction, the green jobs and occupation. What is green jobs and occupation? We discuss about sustainable Tibet. What is green jobs, green occupations? The green jobs as defined by the ILO refer to employment in any industry that contributes to preserving or restoring environmental quality in that sector and allowing for sustainable development. Like for example, motor mechanic. Motor mechanic is our occupation. And how can we make that green jobs? Means if our mechanics do not throw the used mobile or grease to the water resources, or let's say drainage, river, and sometimes, you know, motor, if you go to the motor garage, motor workshops, they throw the, you know, used mobile to the earth, to the soil. So, which, you know, negatively impact to the quality of soil. And we cannot produce organic vegetables, organic fruits, and it will badly affect to the environment. That is a simple example. That's why, how to use that mobile, how to use that wastage of the motor garage proper way, in a scientific way, which will not affect to the environment, that is the skills we have to teach. That is a simple example. That's why we have to develop each and every occupation towards greening. That is the key message of green jobs. So we can see every jobs are green jobs. Now, if we see the 6R principle, every jobs are green jobs. Not only, you know, the work as a forester or let's say a technician in the forest, or let's say gardener, only gardener is green jobs, no? If gardener use more chemical to produce flower, that is not green jobs. But even though they are working for flower and plant, so every jobs are green jobs. So we have to change our thinking. That is very important. This includes jobs that help protect ecosystems and biodiversity, reduce energy, materials, and water consumption through high efficiency strategies, decarbonize the economy, and minimize or altogether avoid generation of all forms of waste and pollution. So we have to teach our graduates how to make less pollutions, how to make less wastage, how to accomplish our target, how to accomplish our performance with low energy, less resources. From less resources, how we can achieve high outputs. So that type of, you know, target or let's say skills we have to teach. That's why this is the concept of green jobs and green occupation. So every jobs are green jobs now.
Yes. Yeah.
Industrial affluence. You will not find no more Hilsa. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
In the Burma. And Bangladesh cannot export to other country.
Yeah. And that's why we have to establish first all industry, wastage affluence.
First, from our side, like, you know, because we are responsible for a small component, like Tibet. So we have to think about our responsibility. If we think about whole responsibility of Bangladesh, we will fall in trap. So to minimize the pollution activities in industry, our duty is to produce Tibet or skill graduates who will go for industry to work, who will know about these green jobs.
Right.
That is our duty. Then one day, definitely all workers in industry with Tibet certificate from DTE Bangladesh will think about green jobs, how to maintain environment, and how to, you know, manage waste, and how to maintain clean water. Then definitely the time will change. So, but if we jump to the industry, I know you have to establish that pollution control plant, means they will not do. So we have to contribute from our side. So that, thank you very much. So this is the occupations jobs. And like how to, you know, encourage green jobs, there are some steps. Look, the adoption and mitigation of resources. So that is the one approach we have to take. Similarly, contribution in preserving environmental quality. Then it will contribute for green jobs encouraged. Promotion in protecting ecosystem and biodiversity. Leadership in reducing energy, materials and water consumption. Decarbonization of the economy and encourage of the reduction of pollution and waste. On the other hand, green employment practices encourage the use of energy efficient materials. And see, the green employment practices encourage the use of energy efficient material. So we have to use materials which are more energy efficient. Like, you know, nowadays at home also, the government electricity authority is announcing, please replace your tube light. And this another light is LED light. The LED light means high energy efficiency light. So this type of things. And building materials and maintenance. So during, you know, building construction also we have to think. And proper solid waste management, as you mentioned. Control water supply and reduction of CO2. And the use of green technology. So these are the way to measure, you know, green systems. But all of this we have to teach in our Tibet system. How to apply green technology, how to use energy friendly technology, equipment. And during the, let's say, construction of the building, if we are providing masonry training, we have to teach them what are the materials which, you know, consume less energy at home. If we do not teach them in the technical schools, Tibet systems, when they will go for work, they will not think about that. So our curricula has to change. We have to think about that. So this is the time. Most of them, many countries has already started a lot of, you know, good intervention. So we'll see some of the here. Therefore, building an educational response that supports better planning for greening work is a more clear approach to look at green work. First, as a Tibet institutions, we have to develop green work approach, green work plan, or let's say strategic plan for green jobs or green technology or greening Tibet. We have to develop a new strategic plan. Then, sector studies that investigate the greening of work at micro levels. And each and every occupation, every sectors, we have to conduct research. How can we contribute for greening environment in each and every occupation? So in the occupation is big. Within the occupations, there might be, let's say, 60 different activities, tasks. For example, plumbing. Within the plumbing occupations, there might be 100 of tasks. And we have to very minutely, you know, research in each and every task, how can we minimize the environmental issues? How can we apply green technology? Then based on that, you know, report, or let's say research report, realistic picture of employer-led organizational demand for green work. Then that research will tell, oh, what are the employment or employer-led green technology? Then what are the things we have to consider? So what are the green work demand of the industry? we have to collect. Then improved and more consistent information on green occupations. Then only we can say, oh, these are the occupations for green, we have to ensure them. Then based on the industry demand and green work, we have to revise our curricula. We have to train our human resources. We have to change our technology. If we use old technology and only talk about the green technology in curricula, it will not work. So we need very clear plan to implement this. Okay, any questions so far? Therefore, green skills specialized in an occupations. Like greening occupations, one is field of knowledge. First, in every occupations, we have to provide knowledge to our students. Like if we are providing hotel management training, diploma in hotel management. So in that field, what might be the greening initiatives? There might be energy use, there might be organic and vegetable use. If we, you know, teach them to cook organic vegetables, then farmers will start to produce organic farms. They will not use the chemicals and it will contribute. No. If hotel will buy only organic vegetables or let's say meat, nowadays, you know, there is a big issues about chicken, poultry. The poultry farming, because the birds, chicken birds got injections, so that is not good for health. So the, if we practice that things in hotel management training, and it will contribute. So another is materials work on our way. So what type of materials, you know, in that occupations? What sort of occupations we are teaching in Tibet programs? So we have to carefully assess the materials, what type of materials we are using. So we have to teach them proper material. Like some cases, in the name of microwave and very fast technology, we are making food hot in the plastic pot. That might be very dangerous. So what type of materials will be better for the microwave oven? And with the materials also, the energy will less consume. If we put in some parts in microwave, some parts will take more energy, some parts will take less energy. So we have to assess that. And we have to teach our student technology. Similarly, kinds of goods and services produced, like from that occupations, what sort of, you know, service and goods produced. For example, if we are providing a training for the let's say automotive or mechanical trade. So our mechanical graduates will serve for the mechanical workshop. They will produce some items, maybe nut bolt, all sort of things. So what type of nut bolt produced by mechanical lab or lathe machine will be, you know, environment friendly. So we have to think in that way. Similarly, tools and equipment used. So during our Tibet programs, what sort of tools and equipment we used to teach our students, to train our students? That is also a part of analysis for the greening occupations. Some tools and equipment might be, you know, not friendly with the green technology. So we have to change that approach. So these are the some initiatives we have to take. Okay, therefore, the Skills for Sustainable Development, UNESCO, that is a 2014, mentioned about, in detail you have the handout, so I am not going to talk much. Like world of life, personal, lifestyle, ESD is the center. If you see the four different circles, where the, you know, integrated approach, education for sustainable development means education for sustainable consumption and lifestyle, citizenship, Tibet for sustainable production, world of work like professional, and entrepreneurial education, problem solving, innovations, life skills education, lifestyle education. These all are the component of education for sustainable development. So in our Tibet curricula, are we teaching them entrepreneurial education or not? We have to think. If our present curricula is not cover enterprise entrepreneurship development, then we have to revise our course. Because we have to produce our graduates for self-employment. If we produce only for wage employment, there might be high unemployment rate. Similarly, there is a like project work for problem solving and innovations or not. How is our curricula? We have to get the answer of this. Similarly, GIGET for sustainable productions, like greening concept is there or not. We have to teach. And citizenship, like you know, civic skills. There is a complaint from the society. The new generations are not much civilized. Like we can talk each other. Like our generation can respect seniors, but young people respect only mobile. There is if some guests come in the home and they stay in sofa and they talk with Facebook or chat, they never talk with us. Means we are producing our students, our graduates, without civic society, civic skills. That is a lack of citizenship skills. So if we are far behind that, then moral component we have to add in our system. Okay? So that is a citizenship skill. So these are the components we have to consider in our curriculum. Therefore, the Asian initiatives towards the adoption of clean and green technology. I have given some example here that many countries have done about the green adoption of the green technology. For example, China. Investment in renewable energy more than any other country. Now, China has invested a lot for renewable energy. If we go, you know, rural setup of the China, everywhere we will see the solar energy. Instead of other part. So that is the one initiative. And creation of national policy that sees clean and green as a major market in the future. And China is the, I think, China occupied 90% of the solar panel market in the world. See? 90%. Everywhere except some European country. In most of the country, the solar panel export from China. And that is also contributed because of solar panel production in China. They are contributing for the green technology in the entire world. So that is a one simple example. In India, like transition has already begun on adopting cleaner energy practices. You know, the recently the Prime Minister Modi mentioned 1 month ago, by 2030, there will be no any motor in India run by petrol and diesel and gas. That is his vision. I don't know how it will achieve, but the government strategic vision is that by 2030, there will be all cars run by maybe solar or something else, not from diesel and petrol. So that is the initiatives. And Indian industries are looking on the corporate environmental impact to avoid pressure of unsound environmental practices as well as their own policy for corporate social responsibility, CSR. So these are some initiatives. And Republic of Korea like adopted a national strategy and 5-year plan for green growth, share of green growth toolkits and experiences, and leadership in international efforts to help build physical infrastructure in developing countries. So Korea is initiating that effort. Like in Nepal, community forest management intensified to generate employment and income from sustainable harvesting of forest products. Like, and this is the community forest intervention in the best example in the world of Nepal. Now, many countries occupy. Now, most around 99% forest belongs to the ownership of the community, not the government. When our government took that decision, the forest for preservation of forest increased by 100%. In previous time, like the belongs to ownership of government, many people went to the jungle and they cut the trees and you know destroyed. But now ownership with them, That's why they are preserved. And only one day a week, Saturday, they will open forest for public only for 2 hours, and people will go and the collect the firewood from the already, you know, like dried trees, and from fooders for the animals. So there is a system, and they have to pay. So that type of initiative started. So from that, they need many Tibet graduates to work in that system. That is one example. And in Malaysia, like establishing green economy through the adoption of low carbon emissions use and a well-educated population in the aim of attaining the status as a manufacturing hub in the region. So Malaysia government has initiated that type of things regarding green. And in Malaysia, also one of the best country, and everywhere you can see the green. Either palm tree or rubber tree, because the Malaysia has, if I am wrong, please correct me, madam and sir, the Malaysia replacing rubber tree by palm tree. Like 10, 15 years ago, there were many rubber trees. And I heard that rubber tree, absorb the water and many things and destroy other trees. That's why now government replaced by palm tree, and because of palm tree, Malaysia became the number one oil exporter in the world, palm oil. That is very popular. And because of that, there are many technicians, new occupations emerge. And Bangladesh, like Gramin Shakti, Gramin Energy program initiated as a way to finance household following clean energy solutions such as the installation of solar house systems. Through the microfinance, the Gramin project in Malaysia, especially in the deprived community, and all these Gramin initiatives are led by female, not by male. And Gramin bank will provide loan to the female group, not to the male also. Because male are considered as not trustworthy as female in the financial matter. There is a saying, if mother receives $10, first she will think about the payment of the tuition fee of the children. But if father receives that $10, he will think to go restaurant for drinks.
Not true for a long
time. Yeah, not true, but in general. But in like a country like Bangladesh, the drinks is different thing. But in general, that is true. Mother always think about children, how to educate them, and that's why this Gramin approach also give loan to the female one, not for male. In most of the country, female is considered as treasurer of house. In Nepal also we consider. That's why this Gramin Shakti clean energy project in Bangladesh, if I am wrong, please correct me, respected Joint Secretary sir are here. And so this is also one of the very good initiatives. Previously, the household of the poor segment of the people, they used to lamp kerosene light and moon popular, and during the study, the students get black flame in the nose, and many people sick and eye problems. So now, because of the solar energy, their health condition is very good. So that is the example. And because of the solar projects, many occupations are created, and Tibet programs, through the DTE, many polytechnics has started solar PV technician courses, alternative energy programs. Many countries have done. These are some examples, like Sri Lanka, Pakistan, and Philippines. Most of the country have done very good job. Like in Philippines, I have seen only in Philippines very good fishery technical schools. So if any people are interested from other countries, people can visit those fisheries technical schools in Philippines. They do harvesting, and they do the crab, prawns and fish. Produce siblings. That is a very good project here in Polytechnic. So that is contributed a lot. And And there is a one of, I forgot that, what is called sea. There is a plant in the ocean.
Seaweed.
That is very popular. So that has contributed a lot for the environment. Environment as well as food security also.
And I think they know how to make the fish dry.
Yeah.
Dry fish. For preserving for the long time.
Long time. For dry fish, even Maldives is better than Philippines. Maldives, they are very good. And Philippines also, there is some polytechnics in Philippines. They have put that dry fish in the village and put in the showcase for sale. Yeah, polytechnics is earning lot of money and export to other countries. So these are some examples. So these are some initiatives our member countries and other countries are taking. Like Bhutan's case, most of you might know, in the Bhutan, that is also green initiatives. Bhutan allow only quality tourism. If you can spend $250 per day, then only you are allowed to enter Bhutan. Otherwise, you cannot go Bhutan. If you want to go Bhutan without thinking, you know, spending $250, then you have to request him as a guest. Otherwise, you can't. So that is also an initiative taken by government for maintaining environment. They don't want cheap tourists. So that is the principle of Bhutan. And that has contributed to maintain the environment in Bhutan. So if the principle of government is that, then they have to teach hotel management, polytechnics, that type of skills. How to enhance quality tourism? What are the green tourism? What are the, you know, like greening tourism concept? Rural to urban, rural tourism. So that is very important. So these are some initiatives, so we have to think in that way. Therefore, these are the five pillars in Tibet sectors. We have to think about greening Tibet. Number one, we have to maintain our campus, green campus. First, if we talk about greening Tibet and we have curriculum, we want to teach greening Tibet concept. And if our campus is not green, then people will laugh. That's why the number one pillar is maintain green campus. When people enter the Polytechnic Institute or let's say Tibet Institute, they feel wow. So very young, not everywhere plant, well maintained, well waste management plant is there, and the energy has created from the waste, solid waste. If we, you know, show that type of model, then we can say. Another is green technology. Within our Tibet system, we have to use green technology. Similarly, green community. Then Tibet Polytechnic has to contribute to develop green community. For example, adapting community capacity building by extra. Not only our Tibet graduates, we have to give training to the community where we are. If the area of the polytechnic institutions is situated, we have to provide capacity building training for the community. Renewable technology to the community people. Resource support and unique practices. If we do some very greening projects, then community people will love. That is the one example I have to take from Philippines. In one polytechnic called Dipol of Fisheries schools, you know, they provide that fishery related skills to the community, farmer, in addition to regular Tibet program. Then now farmers are producing lot of fish and they are exporting to other province and other country. Similarly, green research. Then, as you know, Education Institute, we have to do very good research. Then only we can deliver demand-led Tibet programs. Without research, we can't. So during research, we have to focus green. So what are the components we have to consider in green technology, green approach? So research we have to do. Then we have to develop green culture. If we develop these four pillars, and if our culture is not green culture, as a principal or let's say coordinator of polytechnic, you, I already mentioned, you threw the lot of food during you eating. Means that is not green culture. That is a simple example. That's why promoting culture like green values, green attitude, green ethics, green practices. If we do not maintain that green culture, and we will be like teacher, like, you know, teacher will teach about the smoking is dangerous for health, and the same time he too is smoke in the class. Means that is not culture. So, as a good Tibet institutions, greening initiatives institutions, we have to maintain green culture. That's why these five pillars are considered as greening Tibet pillars. Green campus, green technology, green community, green research and green culture. Then only we can talk little bit about greening Tibet. Otherwise, if we miss one pillar, we will be handicapped. Therefore, as a recommendation, to maintain greening Tibet, first we have to develop policies and strategies. If we do not have any policies and strategies related to greening Tibet, from higher authority, from government, from ministry, from department, and from school level, provincial governmental level, we have to develop policies and strategies. Long-term policies about greening Tibet. Based on that policy, apply green Tibet framework. Then, like other framework, we have to develop green Tibet framework, considering that five pillars. And awareness programs. So we have to aware our teacher. We have to aware our industry people. We have to aware our parents. We have to aware our, you know, investor in the Tibet sector, like private sector institution, like IDEB. If we provide one greening Tibet training, 2 hours training for IDEB educators, more than, you know, thousands polytechnics will know about this because of IDEB network. So we have to conduct many awareness programs. Then reorient curriculum and human resource development. Then we have to reorient our curriculum. We have to revise our curriculum. The present curriculum might not be supportive for greening Tibet concept. So we have to revise our curriculum, reorient curriculum, then recapacitate the instructors, principals, managers. We need resources for that. That's why we have to provide human resource development training for our Tibet professionals. And promote multi-stakeholders partnership. The single Tibet, like DT or single Tibet Polytechnic Institute cannot implement whole greening concept. For this, we need multi-partnership, like we need the development partners, government contributions, institutions contributions, private sector contributions, industry contributions. We have to seek partnership to implement Tibet program in greening concept. Then research and development. We have to invest for research and development also. Without research and, as we mentioned, in each and occupation we have to do very micro level research, what are the greening component in that particular occupation. We have to think. Based on that, our curricula will be revised. Then implement ESG in Tibet. And at the end, we can implement education for sustainable development in Tibet programs. So this is a continuous cycle, not a one-shot intervention. And then only we can, because we are in the beginning stage about the greening Tibet. So this is a movement. One day we will achieve lot. Then we can contribute for the our next generation. That the concluding message is, I don't want to protect the environment. The Tibet professional should say, I don't want to protect the environment. I want to create a world where the environment doesn't need protecting.
World itself protected.
Yeah, itself protected. So you need not to say I'll protect you.
But environment will protect us.
Yes, yeah, yes. But for that, we have to do our karma better.
Burma better.
Yeah. Yeah.
Never, environment never protect us. Environment destroyed us.
But we are destroying the environment.
Yeah,
yes.
And that's why.
That's why if we do better karma, better work,
yeah,
then environment will be good and environment will protect.
And huge cyclone and huge water.
Okay, so this is the concluding message. That's why to create the world where the environment does not need protecting, we have to produce our Tibet graduates and we have to develop our Tibet systems towards greening technology. That is the concluding message of this session. Okay?
Karma.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
So this is the CPSC concept of greening college, greening campus.
It is excellent.
Okay, any questions?
No question.
Because of time pressure, I did very fast.
No
thank
question,
you very
but,
much.
Campus.
Pardon?
What is campus? What did we learn about green jobs? But I can't understand what is brown jobs.
Brown jobs.
Brown jobs.
Brown jobs?
What is brown jobs?
Brown.
Brown, we are all.
This is the concluding message in this condition, brown jobs, I find.
Okay, please read that.
Good, brown.
Good, brown. Deep course transforming Tibet. The need towards transforming Tibet to a more sustainable option encourages the transforming of brown jobs to green jobs. So,
brown jobs to green jobs. Brown jobs means in like the jobs what we are, you know, not contributing for environment protection.
Right.
Okay.
Green jobs is better than brown jobs.
Yeah. Brown jobs means we do not consider about environment. We do not consider about resource maximization. We just perform our job. Like during plumbing. If we, our target is just to fix 100 meter pipe and get money by Tibet graduates, let's say plumber. That is brown jobs. But another plumber who think about appropriate material and very low resources, you know, and how to consume like less water in the piping system. If he think in that way, that is called green jobs. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. Namaskar.
But we start our session. Already we are late. So,
thank you.
We have to try to complete by 5 p.m. Then the suggestion was we will go to the room. So maybe 5:15, 5:20 or and just get refreshed. We have to start around 5:45 because I heard dinner will be there in the same hall at 6 p.m.
So,
here itself, same place. Here. Just you can go there, refresh and come back. This is the idea. So this tentative plan. But I want to give you more time for the task because yesterday we couldn't complete and we have a project task also. So we'll start discussing with 3 or 4 groups. I need the presentation also. Yes, madam. Which one? 6:00. Dinner today. Welcome. They are going to welcome all the international guests because many are staying outside. They're tomorrow people.
Tomorrow
conference starts. It's like because we are all already familiar for them. But many people like ADB, top person is coming, different from Australia, many countries they are coming. Everybody will come here like a welcome, like a reception they call them. But tomorrow night there is a big dinner somewhere in another place. But today they want to invite all other guests also and we'll be having it in the 6:00. I hear many topics comes. So just quickly we will go to our room, less than half an hour. Just you can refresh and we will come back again. Okay. So the topic of discussion will be emerging information technology applications in the area of Tibet. So if you see here, yesterday we discussed a lot of technology trends or generally trends changes in the sector of Tibet, but if you see generally, especially in the area of technology, we see lot of changes now compared to olden days. Simply, we are using only the blackboard those days, but now everything you can see here. Like all the projections, it is going here, it is going on live also. Whatever morning inaugural program was there, it was seen by all over the world. Okay, it's like webcasting, people are doing this. So the classes are not like olden days. So it was a closed learning, nowadays it is changed to open or flexible learning. So that is explained the area of technology, which is helpful in teaching learning process. But if you see generally, we call this all these neuro, because I still remember the internet technology. In India, I can say like 1995, August 15, it was our Independence Day, the internet was introduced for subscribers. So those days, if you see, it was like 56 kbps speed. I wanted to show my trainees how the internet works, some basic videos. So even for that, it was doing like buffering. But if you observe now the 56 kbps, slowly from that's called PSTN technology, then we got like ISDN technology, then it's like LISLAN technology. So now what is happening is, for your information, many of the premier institutions in India are given something called 1 gigabits per second. It's freely it is given. So because of the technology, people, many institutions are given very good internet. So there is no problem of this communication. Because when the speed was very less, the communication, like it was like buffering, it will be going delay. But nowadays, from example, because of India, I'm telling, from any institution they take class, it can be simultaneously seen in many institutions. So they have like something like 10,000 teachers they want to train simultaneously, they say like that. So they conduct one day program. So where many institutions connect and they do this. That is because of this, all these broadband technologies. So if you see, all the divergent technologies have converged now. So we call, that is why it's called converged trends. And all the wired technologies. Anyway, all of us know all wireless. So all of us are able to access internet. In our mobile, we are able to do. Olden days, we had to go to the PC, we had to use the UTP cable. So the technology trends are changing. And all those things are local those days. Now it is all global. As you know, like global competitiveness is told. So technology also, it is changed. So it's like global level. So all the olden days, you say electronics later, like separate, like chip. Or we call like RLC, something different components are there. Now it is like one chip. Whether we are using whatever is used in a PC, like Intel chip, like we call Intel core, dual core, octa core, whatever. Or like in the mobiles, people are using like Qualcomm technologies. So you may think it is some small chip, but is it integration of, like the size may be bigger than the 3 or 4 size of this. The actual component we start collecting through the breadboard, it will be that much. But all those things are compressed or integrated nowadays. That is why yesterday also I was telling the technology is changing slowly through simulation softwares. So that is why it is not possible for me to assemble one by one as a hardware and test it. So people are using like LabVIEW, Multisim, different softwares they are using, by which the technology is helping us doing all type of simulations. Whether it's a small breadboard, small connected in the small breadboard or big one. So all those things are integrated, which is connected now. So that is how the emerging trends are there now. So if you observe, you have many things. Okay, different technology means you can take any area. Like we call, starting from information communication technology, the biotechnology is different area. Lot of people are doing like research also, not only in Bachelor of Engineering, we call biotechnology, Master of Engineering, and doctorate. And many people are doing related to biotechnology. And I'm sure you are aware of nano, okay? Like all these things, macro technology now is called nanotechnology, like 10^-9. So that area, if you take like energy, like Dr. Ram was telling a lot of things about greening. So all those things. So greening, if you take like solar energy or renewable energy, we call, or it may be wind energy. So we are going to save our environment. We are going to save our, what is that, cost also. Like we are going to use all these bulbs, we have to spend a lot of money, or like pollution also. But in case people are using nowadays like CFL lights, so that is going to do. That is separate area. And related to space technology, if you take, many has come. Even, I think you know, India is launching many satellites. Even we launched something like EduSat. That's just for example. There is an educational satellite which was launched only for the purpose. So from any part of, we have something called like, I can say like transmitter, many studios. Through this transformed classes are lively telecasted, or I can say like It's just like television telecast. Television means we are going to just watch. There the advantage is people can interact. Like 100 institutions can be connected. You can see all those things in the monitor which can be connected. Okay, people can interact also with the teacher. So like that, that space technology is also helping us in many areas. Or like what is happening, like weather. So what is happening, like we are able to know when the rain will be there, whether we may get any like typhoon in Philippines, we get often. So all those things because of this satellite technology, GPS, or nowadays like geography information systems. So all those things. So especially if you take a car, you know, I'll discuss about Internet of Things. Even the car nowadays, it is equipped with all this GPS technology. So people should be aware of those things. TV person is there, he should know that technology also. So like this different areas, like entertainment technology. So if you see like gaming, it's very famous now. Or like lot of movies, if you take animations, like Spider-Man or whatever you take. So olden days, I heard all these things were taken by one by one. Like people used to draw. But now everything is computer animated. So in the area of entertainment technology, if you take, there is also many software like TVET students are working. So people do lot of animations, do lot of graphics, so by which they can do for entertainment. But for information, this animation technologies are very much useful in education purpose also, you know. Especially like Flash software, if you know, the students are developing. We can have like how a carburetor engine works. So if, as a teacher, I can go on discussing, but students will not able to understand that much. Since when I show a real thing, like when a lathe machine works, a student is going to see, he will not forget. But if he is going to see an actual video, it is very good. But nowadays people are seeing wherever the parts cannot be seen, that is made as animated one. Like maybe carburetor engine or like a transformer, any area you take. So how that is working, so that is separately with the entertainment technology people are doing. Similarly like community and rural technology. So lot of work is going on in India, we do lot of things like Philippines also we observed, in the APEC also we do lot of things. So anyway, these are all like interdisciplinary which are very much useful in the area of Tibet also. All these convergent technologies, okay, like biomechanics or like mechatronics. Mechatronics is doing a lot now, like robotic machines or, and even recently I observed, the robot is doing a surgery. That's what I was telling you, okay, if the people started doing like this, we don't know future of doctors, even though we need doctor, but they do like precisely, they say. So they'll be able to do robotic surgery, or as I told you, like agriculture also, lot of equipment has come in this area. Information technology, nanotechnology, all these emerging convergent technologies are going to do a lot in futures. So for which we have to be ready. So olden days when we saw these things like 1980s or 1990s, it was like electronic. 1980s it was like all mechanical later. From 1990s people started calling us all electronic later. From 2000 we started calling them as knowledge world, especially because of all these integrated technologies. It is called as K worker, means knowledge worker. So people started using this. So we call this as fourth industrial revolution. So slowly from the end of this 18th generation, all this steam technology has come. Then beginning of 19th century, all this electricity has come. Then slowly if you see like all these things, like today if you see like Internet of Things, quickly I'll discuss that also. Like 3D printing, nanotechnology, hand-free devices, artificial intelligence. So technology is going on. Lot of changes we are going to see here. All of us, I think our generation is very, you can say like lucky also. We have seen lot of landline phone, up to the latest technology we have seen. But if you ask your son or daughter, like my son and daughter, they may not know what is a landline phone also. Because everything like smartphone, nowadays kids are giving only the Android smartphone. So they may not know the even the keyboard type, some small kids. So like this, the technology is changing, the industrial revolution, fourth industrial revolution is going to change a lot for Tibet systems. So we should be ready for this. So if you observe the emerging trends, this is what is expected. Like 2015 if you start, and for example, just I can quickly read this also, like 2018, they call like, it's going to happen like this. There are a lot of predictions. Like 2019, they are telling like doctor in China carries out remote surgery and patient in Ghana. So this may be like telemedicine. Okay, already telemedicine is happening where doctors are doing or giving consultations. So what they want to say is somebody is going to do operation there. It may be also remote. I don't know, because all the robot may be here. They are going to control from remote area. So if you take like biomedical technician or robot technicians needed there. So there also our Tibet person is going to play a lot of role. And like a license granted for driverless, say 2021 they are expecting like driverless cars. So license will be given like individually vehicle. But I don't think so, like our country, I don't know. Like India, Bangladesh, some other country may be difficult. Like recently, China was very good. They are doing very well. Or like Singapore, Malaysia, at least I am telling Asia Pacific countries, if the roads are good without these issues. So even I saw some video like where even the parking of the vehicles is done automatically now. So already is done, people are doing. But anyway, what they want to say is licenseless it is going to come. And 2022, world's first fully automated and robots served hotel opens. So in the hotel also they say, so the robot is going to do everything. So even we have a video like through this WhatsApp, you are getting like this. So a robot is doing cooking. Yeah, it is doing. But see, we are very happy that lot of technology is coming. But one side we have to worry also what happened to our Tibet people. So I don't know what happened. So we have to analyze that. Anyway, all these things we can also think and we can try to develop these. As I told you, like technology, all these things quickly, technological changes are happening and the labor market shift is going to happen. So the increased rate of technological innovations, especially is happening micro technology or microelectronics, biotechnology or like new materials. So olden days, even for our body parts, so we gave like different parts are given. Now you know like already artificial valve is there. So that is because of the material. So people are making lot of biomaterial which is going to help, which is not affect any of our body. So they have to make like that. They should adjust, lifelong they have to manage. That is why like artificial kidney, artificial heart. Okay, people are doing that biomaterials area also. So everywhere latest developments are happening. The cross-cutting nature of technological change. And one more thing is shortened technology of life cycles and the flexibility in meeting the needs. And this is what I am telling. Increase automation with a smaller role for unskilled labor. Once it is happening like this, and our Tibet people should be very skilled. Because they will be able to control the robot also. That is also important. So they have to learn all those technologies. I cannot say that I am no only like old technology. I cannot go this more latest one. So they have to learn, or we have to try to improve or include all these things in our curriculum also. Whatever we, that's what SC also I was telling. Like if somebody is doing related to car servicing, we cannot simply say I'll be doing only the olden days car. So they should be ready for all this in case the wireless, a driverless car comes. So that car will have lot of facilities. So as a technician, I should be able to